being a deep-thinking young high school upstart outcast, or a young Autobot just trying to do the right thing. It is my humble honor tonight to bring to you Mr. Judd Nelson! Same way, usually, you guys gave me some card questions. We're going to ask you those, but first, let's chat a little bit. How you doing?
I'm doing okay. Having fun here.
Yeah. What do you think? Is your first Botcon?
Yeah, it is, and I think people have been really enthusiastic. Everyone's been very friendly. I've enjoyed myself. Thank you all very much. And a lot of people have beards, and I don't really like that.
Installment plan. One day I've stopped the puberty. So, you been finding this okay so far? You having fun?
I'm having fun.
To people. Let's talk about Transformers.
Absolutely.
Was Transformers your first voice role?
Yes, it was.
Yeah?
Yeah, I heard that Orson Welles was doing it. So I was like, wow, I want to work with Orson Welles.
Yeah.
And then got the role, and Orson Welles wouldn't work with anyone. He came the day before us, and he went alone.
Yeah.
And I hear that he told the director, I will give you 3 takes of every line, you won't direct me, and we'll move on. And it turned out he was great, so. Orson Welles.
So, how is that experience outside of missing out on the team? How is that different than your theater and film work? How'd you find voice work?
Well, we didn't have any rehearsal, which is a little odd. You get the script and you read through it and then you show up there and you do it. And you had most of the other actors who you were in the scenes with, and you read them. And a lot of these people were just legends. All the voices from all the cartoons that I saw as a kid. There were some great actors, like Robert Stack and Lionel Stander. I loved it. I kept asking them questions, tell me about this, tell me about that, and the director was like, come on, man, we got work to do. But I really liked it, I thought it was fun. Sue Blue,
it's
incredibly great.
There's a fun fact in the questions about her later on.
I know, I've done some work for her that she's directed on Ben 10.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And she is so fun and pleasant and positive and fast. There's something great about it. You don't have to go through hair and makeup or wardrobe. You just come in like a slob you are, or like I am. And you just get right to it, and I really enjoy it. You also, I find you can take tremendous liberties with the voice. Like things you would never dare do if it were live action. You can make yourself be a complete moron, a complete idiot, go way over the top. And they'll be like, that's not enough, you want more. It's like, okay, you know. It was fun. It was very freeing, and it's always been fun.
And you've done a couple other roles since then. You mentioned Ben 10. You've had a chance to reprise Rodimus at some point and animate it.
Which is funny, because now more time has passed in my life since I did Transformers the movie than I lived before Transformers the movie. So I'm like Hot Rod's dad. on Ben 10, I played one of the Bens, and a couple of other roles, like back. It's fun when you get to play a voice that's like more evil.
Yes.
So it's been great, I dig it.
Awesome. So, let's get to you guys' questions. That's an awesome grammatical structure there. Let's see what we got here. I apologize in advance.
It's okay.
What has been your favorite fan interaction at Botcon so far?
Someone today gave me a friendship bracelet.
Do the old David Letterman thing. They
want to put this. And the crashing sound, like.
Awesome. Can someone do that for me?
You can do it for you. There you go.
Beautiful. Who is your favorite actor that you've ever worked with? That's all. Really, any questions?
I really like them all. I would say the one I learned the most from was probably John Hurt, the English actor. I did From the Hip with him. And there was a moment where I hate messing up lines. Just hate it. I feel it's my responsibility to know them all before I get there and can't make a mistake like that. And I messed up this line in the middle of a long speech. And I was about to kick a chair. And John Hurt went, "Hold on." And he quickly took off his shoe and his sock. And he showed me his foot, and he had his mangled toe. And I went, "What's that?" He goes, "I got upset once. I didn't know my lines. I smashed my foot." You know? I was like, "Thank you." How did you guys get that story out of him? That's awesome.
All right, there's a lot here. What was the name of the movie you did when your character killed a woman and placed them in the lake? Was it Cabin by the Lake? Was that...
Yes.
Yes, and that. But there's an addendum to this. It says, also I had the biggest crush on you during Breakfast Club.
That's great. I like the connection to drowning women and I have a crush on you.
Yeah. Whoever you are.
Excellent. I only drown people in the movies. I don't do that.
It's kind of dark fast.
Yeah, it happens.
It's a kid's show, guys. Come on. Do you have any toys of yourself? So that could go to another weird place, too.
I do not have any toys of myself. I'll leave it at that.
You get so many hot rods by the end of this. When did you realize that that you were so iconic to Transformers fans, the other half of that? So when was that moment for you?
Maybe it's happening now. I'm fascinated that Transformers has lasted as long as it has. I think maybe it has something to do with the complexity of the story and the depth of the characters, but certainly doing it, I didn't have the sense that this was going to be something that 30 years from now people are going to still want to be a part of. And the animation, compared to like Jurassic Park, it's very rudimentary, which leads me to believe that the appeal of it is not the artwork necessarily, so much as it is the depth of the relationships and how characters keep evolving. And there are some wonderfully, there are great good bad guys in this series, and I think maybe, I mean, I play a kind of a stiff. He's not really, he's more like the audience.
Yeah.
And so in a way that's a good character to play because people can see it through your eyes.
Yeah.
But it's less like the evil villains are just great.
Yeah. Well, you were the vehicle, no pun intended, through which the audience actually watched this movie because we were all kids at the time.
What I think's amazing is there have been people that I've met who have come over with their kids.
Yeah.
And they're like, "Oh yeah, my kids watch the show." No, the kids don't watch the show. I have no idea what's going on. It's the parents.
I think that's great. Excuse me, man.
Yeah. Kids are like blank looking around.
All right, what's this? What attracts you to a role? Are there any favorite characters or characteristics?
Well, I think almost anything can attract me to a project. Sometimes it's the role, sometimes it's the script, sometimes it's the actors you'll get a chance to work with, sometimes it's the location. One time it was the location they were filming at. I always wanted to go to Australia.
Yeah.
I got sent a script for a project in Australia and I was like, yup. My representation was like, "Do you want to give it a read?" I go, "No. I mean, am I new?" "Yup, I'll do it." And so it's really any number of things. Usually, it's the script as a whole. Because to play a great character in a script that's not so good, it just doesn't, it's not as, you know, the film won't be as good, and I'd rather be a small part of a great, larger thing.
Yeah. But what are you working on now? What's on the horizon that's coming out this year?
Two films that are in the can. One is called Creep with a K.
Okay.
And that is with Lamari Nadell.
Okay.
And it's a contemporary Western-esque kind of story. And then I just finished my first real Western called Stagecoach, The Legend of Texas Jack, with Trace Atkins and Kim Coates. And I, you know, rode a horse, sort of. We rocked Stagecoaches, for real. And I really enjoyed it.
So what's that called again?
Stagecoach, The Legend of Texas Jack.
All right, that sounds really exciting. It's
you know, it's horses are kind of serious things. They will do what they want.
All right, let's see here. Any memories you can share from Transformers the movie in 1986 from the recording sessions? And addendum, did you know Sue Blue had a crush on you?
Oh. No, I didn't know that.
And now you do.
Yeah, it's a little late now, right? We should knock on her door. Hey, 3 years late,
actually. Good question.
Okay. I'm glad I know it now.
Yeah.
You know, future reference. No, I'll be too embarrassed to say it. But I really enjoyed just the, every so often some of the other actors would slip into a different voice that was not for Transformers.
Yeah.
And this was in between recording. And one guy's doing like Bullwinkle. And one guy's doing like Professor Peabody from like Underdog. So it was like, it was just crazy voices that I recognized from my youth. I was like, what was that? And I just dug it. That was really great. There were some unheralded performers that are incredibly gifted. Yeah. We just don't know their faces, so we don't see them. In Ben 10, I got to work with Tara Strong.
Yes.
Who only does about 10 billion voices. Incredibly talented.
Yeah.
You know, and a babe, too.
This is fairly straightforward. So this is, what was your favorite role?
The favorite role, maybe, I mean, I really like them all. I have a special affinity for Marty Malt in a very peculiar film called The Dark Backward.
Yeah.
That's about the right odds. Thank you very much. But it's not a film for the squeamish, and it's not really a film for the young. It's not like X-rated or anything, but it is unique and peculiar. And that one I really enjoyed working on. It was hard to convince the director that he should cast me. And then once that happened, it was really fun and great. And we made that pretty quickly for, I think, like a dollar.
It's up for you guys to look at. It's your homework.
Yeah. Don't watch it with your kids. The Dark Backward. The writer director, Adam Rifkin, opened up a book of collected works of Shakespeare and put his finger on it, and that was the term, The Dark Backward, and that's what he named it.
That's a real story.
It's a real story.
That's fantastic.
Unless he was lying.
Wow.
That's a real story for him, yeah. That's how it got its title. That's not how we wrote it, but that's how it is.
All right. Which form of media do you currently prefer to act in? TVs, movies, voice acting, and I'm going to add in your theater.
Well, I think it's all similar. All of them have their strengths or their advantages and their disadvantages. Something that's wonderful about theater is you don't do it until you've rehearsed it, until it's ready. However, when you're on stage and you mess something up, you can't go, oh, hold on a second. So that is not possible. Film, you can sometimes have a rehearsal. For the most part, it's just a blocking rehearsal. They show you where you want to. They want you to be there on that line, maybe be there on that line. So the directors sometimes feel like traffic cops. And you don't really get this sense that the work is fully rehearsed and ready to be performed. But they'll give you 50 chances to get it right. Mm-hmm. But films, films, I think, are made and broken in post-production. You shoot whatever you're going to shoot, and then months later, the director and the editor, they're putting the film together. And it can be almost unrecognizable from the script you read in the movie you thought you were shooting.
Yeah.
For instance, you can have a scene with five lines in it, and you smile on the second line, but you don't smile at the end of the scene because it doesn't work out well for you. You go see the movie, that smile on the second line is now the fifth line. So the scene was one thing, and you go see it, and you go, but that's not what. However, you know, the actor gets a lot of the glamour unnecessarily and unjustifiably, and then a lot of the punishment and shame is unjustifiably also. So you don't have much control as an actor on film. Television, when I did a sitcom for 3 years, it felt like doing a one-act play every week.
Yeah.
You'd rehearse it, and you'd get it ready, and then you'd do it in front of a live audience, and like a couple takes each time all the way through. So you get the feeling of it being pretty ready, and then the audience responds to let you know if it was really ready or if you just thought it was good. And then if it was bad, then you got a new one next week. So it's kind of a little bit, so I like them all for various reasons. I dislike them all for various reasons. I don't have any problem with voiceover stuff. That seems like, go in there, you go for it, and you go,
you don't even need to wear pants, it's great.
And I know that about Sue Blue, I yes, I tend to wear my clothes there.
All right. Coincidentally, next question, do you have any favorite memories from Suddenly Susan?
Lots. Well, I enjoyed working on that show. I knew Brooke Shields beforehand, so that's why I knew that working on the show would be great, because Brooke is very, not just professional, but she doesn't feel that her time is any more valuable than anyone else's. There was never going to be a moment where she was going to think she was better than anyone else. So that you knew, just come ready, and that it would be a kind of egalitarian experience. I really enjoyed that. It had a terrible ending for us. There was a tragedy that happened to one of the actors, and then that was like, wow. So my memory of that experience is still very positive because of Brooke and the other people that I worked with. Though it was a tough way to end it.
Yeah. It was handled nicely on the show, though.
As best as that thing can be handled, yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Try to lighten the mood here, sorry, guys. Okay, let's go for it.
I don't know what the question is.
Okay. If you could transform into anything or anyone, who would it be?
You mean in real life?
I guess so.
Now or throughout history?
I'm going to say anything goes, man.
Okay. Maybe Matthew Brady. He was a Civil War photographer. One of the few people that could travel between the North because he had,
thank you.
Hello?
Oh, yes.
Hello.
He could travel between the North and the South. One of the few people that could do that. And his photographs, as well as a couple of his contemporaries, shortened the war. Because people were sent off to that war. You go be a hero, it's great, excellent. And those photographs, first time that the general population saw the carnage of the battlefield. People were like, yeah, this ain't so good, let's stop this. So
yeah.
I think that particular individual was very instrumental in reducing the general suffering of a country.
Yeah.
I think things are trying to be for a little while.
Which means, yeah. It's basically the birth of broadcast media, so people know what's actually
without a spin.
Yeah.
Without a spin.
Directly. See, whoever asked that question thought it was going to say like a backhoe or something, and you got like a really awesome answer. So, thank you.
Cindy Crawford.
Yeah.
Cindy Crawford. No, I don't mean that. Only a good way.
Man, what is with you guys? All right, who was your childhood crush?
You mean of people that people might know?
Yeah, I I guess being in
I mean, you know, school, you know, like sixth grade, you're not gonna know who this girl is. Unless she's here, then I'm gonna be chilly. On my wall when I had been growing up as a kid, I had three posters. One was Peter Fonda and Dennis Hopper from Easy Rider.
Nice.
One was Raquel Welch from 6 billion years BC. She had the kind of fur.
Yeah.
And one was Sophia Loren.
Oh, yes.
And a dress, a wet dress. So,
oh, yes.
Of those three, Sophia Loren.
Sophia Loren?
Yeah.
I'm with you.
Good.
Lots of weird. All right. Would you ever play the role of Rodimus again?
Oh. Sure.
Maybe we should kind of make that kind of happen. All right. Let's see. What do you look for in a role or screenplay? That's kind of, we kind of asked that already, I feel like.
Yeah, I think, you know, it could be anything. Sometimes it's the story can be important, I think. Sometimes it can be really funny. And I haven't read too many scripts that are funny.
Yeah. Have you done stage work?
Yes.
Talk about your stage work. And how does that play into the voice acting?
Well, I think that it's important to work with a partner. You know, don't work in a vacuum. Well, sometimes stage, I mean, voice work, you're all alone.
Yeah.
And you're doing it, and you're making believe there's something to do. And on stage, you know, there's someone in the scene with you, The audience can see if you play off of them with them. I personally like stage the most because you've gone from the beginning to the end dozens of times. It's rehearsed. It's planned. You plan for everything except those things you can't plan for, and then you're happy when those things happen. Because who knows what kind of moments of joy you get when you find something in the material that you've been trying for. Unconsciously you get it rather than consciously. And you start at the beginning and you go to the end. In movies that's very rare. You'll start a scene and go to the end. But you can do the end of the movie the first day of the shoot. And that's just odd. I like starting at the beginning. If you were to have an evening with a woman, you wouldn't want to start at the end. I mean, some people might, but that kind of takes a while. No, it would take all the fun out of it.
The narrative flow would be disjointed of the date that you're on.
The flow would be
disjointed. Yes. Yeah, disjointed flow right here at Botcon 2016.
That's a good name for a Transformer character.
I dig it. Or a punk band. That's fantastic. You know, you're talking about playing other role public characters. Earlier, Greg Berger was talking about how you guys were always in the room at the same time. Did you get to play off of these other guys in that same way to sort of like channel that same energy?
Well, sometimes, you know, because I was very much a novice. You have the microphone, let's say, right here.
Yeah.
But the guy you're playing the scene is over there. So you might forget to go, hey, stop, now, put your mouth to the mic. It's like, sorry. So that would be hard first. Yeah. And then you learn, okay. But it's good to feel that around.
Yeah.
You know, that you're in it together. You're not like in a vacuum. And that was really, I enjoyed it.
Yeah, and that was all done. You did that pretty much in the street, in the timeline of the movie, right?
Yes. Yeah, we pretty much went from the beginning to the end.
Yeah.
And we had big round table, lots of performers there. Leonard Nimoy was not there.
Okay.
He had the special, I guess, Orson Welles or anything.
Yeah.
The guys go separate, because they're huge. But the rest of us, it's just great. I really like it.
That's great. Did you keep in contact with him afterwards?
No, not really. And I was really glad to work with Sue Bird. It was like,
yeah.
Because it's just, I find time, I have a weird sense of time now. I don't really know when. And living in Los Angeles, there's no real change of seasons.
Yeah.
So you don't know when, how much time has gone by. So like, what year was that? It's like, I don't know. I think Reagan was president. Which Bush I don't know. So we end up losing touch. It's a myth, you know, the idea that you work on a project and you're all family.
Yeah.
Maybe you are then, but
as soon as that project's over, some people go to that project or go to that project. You kind of, it all scattered all everywhere. So I've lost touch with people, and this coming here to this is really good because I just now just seen people I haven't seen and realized a long, long time.
It's cool.
That's kind of crazy. And now you told me the thing about Sucos.
Well, we kind of feel like this is a family reunion, like I was saying. You know, you're part of the family, man. This is great.
Glad to have part.
I love it. All right. Here, this is interesting. Who were some of your favorite childhood characters? Clearly, this entire room, you are their favorite childhood character.
Ah, thank you.
But what were yours?
You mean like cartoon characters?
Yeah, sure. Or other things that you
really like. Bullwinkle and Rocky.
Yeah.
I really like Bullwinkle and Rocky. I like them. Just, I don't know what it was. The ones that I thought were rather peculiar were Davy and, you know, Davy.
Oh, Davy and the Lions.
Those were, I thought, a little bit odd. When I got older and then discovered marijuana, I really liked that show a lot. Really, why? I liked Speed Racer because the background movie, but not the car. Again, in that marijuana time. It really, the show that I would go out of my way to see was Bullwinkle.
Yeah.
All the little, just so strange, just wonderful, even breathe.
Yeah. The fairy tales just got more fractured as the years went on.
Yes, yes.
All right. In what city did you record the animated movie? Who was there that day?
Burbank, California, was where the sound studio was. And there were, I don't know, at least a dozen actors. My favorite of that group, though, was Lionel Standard. Had a role in Heart to Heart.
Yes.
Gravel, I think. It's also in a great movie, one of the first Roman Polanski movies called Cul-de-Sac. Might have been Jacqueline Bisset's first movie. And if you get a chance to see that, it's very odd, as Polanski movies are. I would not let the kids see that one either. But Lionel Standard had Gravel, and was like, wow, 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 it's great. So Burbank and
Which kind of leads into the next question. What was it like working with Robert Stack, specifically Robert Stack?
Well, this was before he'd done, the iconic, Unsolved and all that stuff. So he'd done The Name of the Game. Remember that show? The Name of the Game? Like one of those CBS movies of the week. And him, Tony Franciosa, I think, did them periodically. So, you know, he had a cool voice, but it wasn't like I was going,
kind of serious.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. I think you answered that.
Just mentioning pop what's happening.
Which kind of plays into this one. What's your favorite pizza? Serious. It actually says that. Someone asked, "What's your favorite
pizza?" My favorite pizza is plain, just cheese, but also very close second, pepperoni.
Yeah.
And I don't understand pineapple. I feel like, when your tomato sauce gets on your salad.
I like that there's one guy who's really excited about pepperoni over there. Just shocked up. That's a pepperoni.
I think it's the same guy I said about the pot.
Right? Yeah. All right, we got two more left, and we're just about out of time anyway. Let's see. How do you feel about the character that you played in the 1986 movie? I'm pretty sure you're talking about Anra. And how that character reflects the Transformers franchise. So, yeah, let's just kind of sum that up.
Well, it's interesting because he starts out as one thing,
yeah,
and becomes something else. He evolves, he grows, he matures. He's more reactive and juvenile, mm-hmm, and then becomes someone who has to be responsible for things, and he takes care of business.
But then after that, there are lots of incarnations, lots of different names Hot Rod gets.
Yeah.
Which was referenced a couple days ago when we did that. It was like, God, why was I calling myself Rod as a major in late aughts?
Yeah.
It's like, but all those, I think, are symptomatic of the success of Transformers.
Yeah.
That things expand beyond their original cast and become bigger and better. If they don't become better, they come back and start again and something else.
Yeah.
And it's called Transformers. There is a transformation. It's not necessarily from a humanoid to a vehicleoid. Though that does happen.
Yeah.
There are other kinds of transformations that happen throughout the story, good guys, bad guys. So I think that's, he is symptomatic the way all old characters are symptomatic of what the franchise, what it began with, and what it continues to be today, which is a transformation from one thing to another with a connecting tissue.
That's great. That's excellent.
And that the audience has a right to, which is,
yeah.
Well, I find this so fascinating.
Yeah.
Very cool.
This is the hero's journey that Hot Rod was on.
Fast.
Exactly. Rolling into a Winnebago. That's weird. That's weird. Last question. Which is a weird one. I feel like I should have ended up that one. That was really good. This is, what do you think of Optimus Prime?
Oh. I think.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thank you all very much.